So, breathing hard, we waited until morning. When dawn spread out her fingertips of rose, the rams began to stir, moving for pasture, and peals of bleating echoed round the pens where dams with udders full called for a milking. Blinded and sick with pain from his head wound, the master stroked each ram, then let it pass. But my men, riding on the pectoral fleece, the giant's blind hands blundering never found. Last of them all, my ram, the leader, came, weighted by wool and me with my meditations. The Cyclops patted him, and then he said, "Sweet cousin ram, why lag behind the rest in the night cave? You never linger so, but graze before them all, and go afar to crop sweet grass, and take your stately way leading along the streams, until at evening you run to be the first one in the fold. Why now so far behind? Can you be grieving over your master's eye? That carrion rogue and his accursed companions burnt it out when he had conquered all my wits with wine. Nobody will not get out alive, I swear. Oh, had you brain and voice to tell where he may be now, dodging all my fury. Bashed by this hand and bashed on this rock wall, his brains would strew the floor, and I should have rest from the outrage nobody worked upon me." He sent us into the open then. Close by, I dropped and rolled clear of the ram's belly, going this way and that to untie the men. With many glances back, we rounded up his fat, stiff-legged sheep to take aboard and drove them down to where the good ship lay. We saw, as we came near, our fellows' faces shining. Then we saw them turn to grief, tallying those who had not fled from death. I hushed them, jerking head and eyebrows up, and in a low voice told them, "Load this herd, move fast, and put the ship's head toward the breakers." They all pitched in at loading, then embarked and struck their oars into the sea. Far out, as far offshore as shouted words would carry, I sent a few back to the adversary. "Oh, Cyclops, would you feast on my companions? Puny am I in a caveman's hands? How do you like the beating that we gave you, you damned cannibal? Eater of guests under your roof? Zeus and the gods have paid you." The blind thing in his doubled fury broke a hilltop in his hands and heaved it after us. Ahead of our black prow it struck and sank, whelmed in a spewing geyser, a giant wave that washed the ship stern foremost back to shore. I got the longest boat hook out and stood fending us off, with furious nods to all to put their backs into a racing stroke, row, row, or perish. So the long oars bent, kicking the foam sternward, making head until we drew away, and twice as far. Now, when I cupped my hands, I heard the crew in low voices protesting. "God's sake, Captain, why bait the beast again? Let him alone. That tidal wave he made on the first throw all but beached us."
"All but stove us in."
"Give him our bearing with your trumpeting. He'll get the range and lob a boulder." "Aye, he'll smash our timbers and our heads together." I would not heed them in my glorying spirit, but let my anger flare.
1062.
And yelled, "Cyclops, if ever mortal man inquire how you were put to shame and blinded, tell him Odysseus, raider of cities, took your eye. Laertes' son, whose home's on Ithaca." At this he gave a mighty sob, and rumbled, "Now comes the weird upon me spoken of old. A wizard, grand and wondrous, lived here, Telemus, a son of Eurymus. Great length of days he had in wizardry among the Cyclopes, and these things he foretold for time to come. My great eye lost, and at Odysseus's hands. Always I had in mind some giant, armed in giant force, would come against me here. But you, small, pitiful, and twiggy, you put me down with wine. You blinded me. Come back, Odysseus, and I'll treat you well, praying the god of earthquake to befriend you. His son I am, for he by his avowal fathered me. And if he will, he may heal me of this black wound, he and no other of all the happy gods or mortal men. Few words I shouted in reply to him. If I could take your life, I would, and take your time away, and hurl you down to hell. The god of earthquake could not heal you there. At this, he stretched his hands out in the darkness toward the sky of stars and prayed Poseidon. Oh, hear me, Lord, blue girdler of the islands. If I am thine indeed, and thou art father, grant that Odysseus, raider of cities, never see his home. Laertes' son, I mean, who kept his hall on Ithaca. Should destiny intend that he shall see his roof again among his family in his fatherland, far be that day, and dark the years between. Let him lose all companions, and return under strange sail to bitter days at home. In these words he prayed, and the god heard him. Now he laid hands upon a bigger stone and wheeled around, titanic for the cast, to let it fly in the black proud vessel's track. But it fell short, just aft the steering oar, and whelming seas rose giant above the stone to bear us onward toward the island. There, as we ran in, we saw the squadron waiting, the trim ships drawn up side by side, and all our troubled friends who waited, looking seaward. We beached her, grinding keel in the soft sand, and waded in ourselves on the sandy beach. Then we unloaded all of Cyclops's flock, to make division, share and share alike. Only my fighters voted that my ram, the prize of all, should go to me. I slew him by the seaside and burnt his long thigh bones to Zeus beyond the storm cloud, Cronus's son, who rules the world. But Zeus disdained my offering. Destruction for my ships he had in store, and death for those who sailed them, my companions. Now all day long until the sun went down, we made our feast on mutton and sweet wine, till after sunset in the gathering dark we went to sleep above the wash of ripples. When the young dawn with fingertips of rose touched the world, I roused the men, gave orders to man the ships, cast off the mooring lines, and filing in to sit beside the rowlocks, oarsmen in line dipped oars in the gray sea. So we moved out, sad in the vast offing, having our precious lives, but not our friends.
All right, let's do a quick annotation now of this passage. There's a whole lot that obviously goes on in this passage that we'll come back to as we begin our project of talking about it. Notice right away, first of all, let's put it in our notes right away. Notice that when they arrive at the land of the Cyclops, right away Odysseus makes the observation. Remember, he's talking to Alcyonus, the king of the Phaeacians, very cultured people. He says, where we showed up, these Cyclopes, they have no culture. They have no respect for law. They do not understand the law of Xenia, that idea that when you're with somebody, you're supposed to be hospitable. Don't know any of that at all. And so right away, he says, we knew we were probably in for trouble. Notice he says that there was this prodigious, huge man who shows up, right? The idea, of course, as well, ironic, notice already some irony, his sailors tell him, let's just steal his stuff and go. And he's like, no, I want to find out some things, right? Notice we have that this Cyclops Polyphemus, he's reared in solitude at line 134, right? Odysseus decides to take his 12 best fighters with him and wine. Notice the similarity of symbolism between wine and lotus. Both of them are somehow going to capture the mind and allow you to not be, right, correct. And to that degree, notice then we've got, in both of these readings, admonitions to stay away from anything that would jack with your mind. We've obviously got some foreshadowing, right? That will say at line 153, a wineskin full, I brought along with victuals in a bag, for in my bones I knew some towering brute would be upon us soon. And yet, Odysseus still wants to go. They get to the cave, his pals say, let's go, we can steal this stuff. But it's Odysseus, and it is Odyssean. He has tremendous curiosity. No, I want to stay. I want to see this big old thing. I want to figure out what's going on. Odysseus' curiosity, of course, leads him to all kinds of problems. The giant comes in. He asks who they are. He immediately starts to eat them, right? Okay, there's a dread, obviously. He insults, right, Odysseus at line 219 or so, calls him a ninny, a wimp, a small guy. Notice he says, we Cyclops, at line 220, we Cyclops care not a whistle for your thundering Zeus and all the gods in bliss. We have more force by far. I would not let you go for fear of Zeus. You are your friends. Notice he says, we don't pray. Notice how this passage ends. He ends up praying, sending a curse, of course. Odysseus is a great liar, right? He tells him that his ship was jacked. Of course, we've got the man-eater then, who then goes to sleep. Odysseus is smart. Let's put that in our notes. He's cunning, he's wily, he's smart, right? In the morning, more men are eaten, and then we're told at line 263, he began to ponder. He has to figure it out. He's got the olive tree, he's going to turn it into a huge telephone pole with a point, and he's a survivor. Let's put that in our notes. Odysseus is a survivor. He knows how to, notice he doesn't panic. Instead, he figures out he can't kill him because then, of course, they're stuck inside the cave. They're never going to get out, right? Wine is the key, turns the Cyclops crazy mad. Asks Odysseus about a name to begin with, and of course the famous line, me, I am nobody, which is of course going to play obviously all the way to the end, right? And the gift that he's going to give to Odysseus is, I'll eat you last, right? They ram it into the eye. Notice the disgusting description of that. And notice the simile as well on page 1056. A smithy who sees a white hot axe head in the fire plunged, right? Then we've got the howl, and of course we find out that his name is Polyphemus because his buddies come around, and again, no man has tricked you, ruined you. In other words, nobody, right? Okay. Finally, we find out that Odysseus is going to laugh about what he's done. The giant stands in the doorway. Notice he says, I had to figure out a way to draw on all my wits at line 373 and run through my tactics. He ties three sheep together. They hang on the underside of the sheep. He hangs onto the other side of the largest sheep. Note the irony when he's asked, when the sheep is asked by the stupid Cyclops, right? Why are you last? You must be grieving. I wish that you could talk, right? And then, of course, I'd be able to, know where he is. The last part of our story is fascinating. Odysseus is one of those guys. Do you know people like this at 3B? They just cannot let it go. So it's not enough to win. He's got to taunt. He's got to, right, got to say something. And, of course, that almost leads to serious amounts of problems. Again, notice his men are giving him good advice. Would you just shut up? He wants to taunt some more. There is some foretelling, however, that goes down here. Cyclops will say, I was told that somebody named Odysseus was going to jack me. I just figured it wasn't some little puny thing like you. Finally, calls to his father Poseidon and makes a special prayer. Make sure Odysseus does not get home. Make sure all of his men die. Why is Odysseus at the land of the Phaeacians? Because he's been jacked on the island of the island of Calypso for all those years. Why did he end up there? Because all of his men drowned. Why did they drown? Because they ate the favorite cattle of Apollo. Why did all that happen? Because he blinded a Cyclops early in his trip back from Troy. In other words, there are ramifications for acts, right? So in 2A, you can jot down a possible message that there are ramifications for acts, right? There is always payback. And the story always, of course, shows that as well. At 2B, obviously we've got the epic hero motif, no question. Odysseus, as well as a great, we got all kinds of symbolism going on here, as well as the irony that we've pointed out. At 3A, think about a great story where a guy has to use, or a gal has to use her mind to kind of get out of a situation, right? Okay? To try and stay alive in some ways. And finally at 3B, when was the last time you were in a situation where you really had to use your wits to be able to get out of a situation? Or when was the last time you fooled somebody really well? Who are you? Oh, my name is Nobody, okay? It works out rather nicely, right? And this thing about names will be an important part of our reading of the Odyssey. Okay, thanks guys. We'll come back to work some more.